There's obviously a lot of detail that you can talk about when we, you know, consider front of neck access and surgical techniques. For example, why do we use a 5mm syringe? And you know, a 5mm syringe is just really easy to hold in your hand. It's not too bulky like a 10 or 20mm, but also has enough of a chamber to show positive aspiration of air. A 2mm syringe probably, or a 1mm syringe probably doesn't have enough volume there. Obviously, there's a lot of different 14-gauge cannula types that could be used, but we choose to use the BD Insight for a couple of reasons. So let's look at each of these cannulas in detail. BD Insight cannula is really useful because, first of all, you can take the back of the chamber off, and then that's where you can actually attach a syringe and check for the positive aspiration of air. But also, this cannula isn't a safety cannula, so you can reinsert this needle. One other really special part about this is that the cannula plastic doesn't have memory. So if you were to scrunch this up like so, it just folds back into the right kind of trajectory and it stays patent. Really important when you're doing surgical airways. This is another Insight cannula, but it's a safety cannula, and it's really hard to take this tip off. It's not normally able to come off, and you can't really attach this. So this cannula just won't do. It's a safety cannula, so it's got a needle that retracts. The cannula itself is probably the same material, so it's probably still very useful. Now this cannula here, this is a BD Venfon cannula. It's quite interesting. So just to show you the mechanics of this cannula, if I was to kink this cannula, it seems to still stay obstructed, as you can see. Whereas the BD Insight cannula just doesn't have that problem. It seems to spring back normal and stay patent. Again, really useful when you're doing surgical airways. So there's a few common pitfalls that you just shouldn't do when doing the needle crank technique. Now, the first one is, we'd all be very used to pre-loosening the cannula, and that's an absolute disaster. If you pre-loosen the cannula, it means that there might be a gap resulting in a false aspiration of air. Also, it's really important, as you're inserting, you want to aspirate on the syringe. Now, what you definitely don't want to do is, if you miss on the first attempt, you don't want to withdraw while still aspirating, because then the cannula could separate, and again, you might get a false aspiration of air, because now there's a hole there because the needle isn't flush with the cannula. If you're unsuccessful in your first attempt, you want to remove both devices together so that they still stay joined prior to getting the first aspiration of air. Now, in a standard neck, you want to be really careful about the angle of insertion. Like we say, 45 degrees, because that way you get a nice trajectory of a few centimeters into the tracheal wall. If you were to do a vertical insertion of this cannula, you'll find that there's less distance vertically than there is at a 45 degree angle. So again, an angled insertion is better. Now, if you do have a deep neck, you may need to go to a steeper angle just so that you reach the trachea if the neck tissue is very large. Another mistake is in your insertion attempt, you don't want to be jiggling the cannula back and forth, but again, that can cause a disconnection between the needle and the cannula, causing a false aspiration of air. Now, there's a couple of ways that the Melker insertion goes wrong. So one of the ways is incorrect grip. For example, if I'm not gripping all of these devices together, that means that there's, you know, I'm not gripping the cricothyroidotomy, the dilator, and the wire, you can get separation. And so what that means is that the dilator might actually get pushed out, and that's not good, because now you've got a distance between the wire and the cricothyroidotomy kit. The dilator allows it to be a really smooth surface between, so it easily passes through. Another way that this can fail is if you do the incorrect skin incision. For example, if your skin incision is too small and the skin is really tough, it'd be very hard to pass the Melker through. So a small skin incision is obviously not a great idea. Now, another thing is maybe you're not comfortable with the scalpel up against a wire, and so you cause this skin bridge. So say there's a bridge between, or there's a piece of skin between where the scalpel incision is and the wire. This Melker device, it's going to be hard to push down because there's no join between that incision. Another way this can go badly is if I make an incision onto the wire itself, you might get shearing of the wire. This is obviously really dangerous because then you get shards of wire. Now, another step that we often see happening is the incorrect force applied. For example, if your force is applied just in a downward direction, then it might not have the same force to get through that hole. Whereas if you apply it with the right motion, that means initially downwards, down into the trachea, then inferiorly, with a rotating motion, that's more likely to get in to your trachea and allow you to properly ventilate this patient later. After I've inserted the Melker, I want to make sure that this is in the trachea and in ventilating the lungs, so I'd always be checking my end-tidal CO2 if possible, and that my oxygen saturations are rising, as well as good chest rise and fall. So that was a few ways that your needle crank might fail. So again, really pay attention to these subtleties in the technique and practice to make sure that if this situation does happen, you're able to solve that problem.